Longwood. In 1815, there stood here a kind of barn erected in 1755, at the time when Governor Dunbar, thinking that this plain was fertile, had it put under cultivation. The first harvest of barley, oats, and wheat gave such hope that this barn was built, together with several other buildings, to accommodate the company's farmers, but the succeeding harvests having produced nothing, the barn was transformed into a country house for the lieutenant governor. This agricultural failure was attributed to the climate and to some peculiarity of the soil, and it was officially denied that the seed was consumed by rats. However, these rats were so numerous that in 1756, for lack of any other food, they skinned the gum trees at Longwood. Despite this setback, there was on the island some arable land, and in 1777 it was planned in order to use Longwood in creating pastures to direct water there by means of an undertaking which would have cost immense sums of money. The company momentarily rejected the scheme and decided to replant the woods despoiled by cattle, goats, and sheep. The trees on the island were so uncommon a species that it was forbidden to fell them under severe penalties. All fuel, wood, and coal came from England to plant Longwood. Italian poplars were decided upon because of their rapid growth and the shade they might afford, but they did not flourish. And a return was made to gum trees, which alone were capable of withstanding the wind and of growing in this rocky soil. The enclosure and plantation of Longwood, roughly 600 acres, cost the company more than 8,000 sterling without ever yielding to it a single foot of timber. To prevent a military insurrection like that of 1811, when the lieutenant governor was carried off to Longwood by the mutineers without being able to defend himself, Governor Wilkes, who had wonderfully developed Chinese labor in the islands, planned in 1813 to put under cultivation certain stretches of land on the plain at a place called Deadwood, and to station troops there. He had cleared and enclosed a piece of 36 acres in which he combined barracks, guard rooms, a government house, a hospital, and other buildings, and which he maintained and watered by means of aqueducts and reservoirs, the construction of which cost 13,000 sterling. This conglomeration of buildings was erected on the same plain as Longwood, but a fair distance from it. The water, which contained much magnesia, as was also scarcely fit for drinking purposes without being firstly boiled, was directed by canals only to the Deadwood barracks, for Longwood drinking water had to be fetched from a spring, a distance of 1,200 meters from the house, and carried in open casks, which had contained wine or rum, and it arrived foul and thick. The cost of living in the Longwood enclosure, the company's cattle wandered at will, and no one disturbed them. Moreover, except in the company's garden, fresh vegetables were hardly ever found elsewhere on the island. The few inhabitants who could make anything out of their land grew only potatoes, which they sold to advantage to the ships in harbor, out of which they grew between 6,000 and 7,000 bushels a year, not caring about products which might have been a little more costly. All articles of food came from the Cape of Good Hope, England, Brazil, or the coast of Africa, but primarily from England and the Cape. So too clothing, furniture, even building materials, and coal, of which, despite the assertions of geographers, not one lump ever was found on the island. A pound of veal cost 6.5 days. Of beef, first quality, 1s, 2d. Second quality, 11 days. Mutton from, I'm not going to read all this. The cows arrived from the Cape like skeletons. The sheep were so thin that now and again at Longwood, a candle would be placed inside a carcass of recently slaughtered sheep before it was cut up and a lantern made out of it. When they came from the Cape, Rio, or Angola, the animals were most often in such a state of exhaustion and consumption that they could not recover on the poor pastures of the island, where, furthermore, they were allowed to chew the cud as little as possible. The sheep grazing passing by a strange phenomenon did not fatten their bodies or legs, but only their tails, which were in consequence large but odious. One lived at the mercy of the wind from day to another, might be reduced to frozen meat. There was no lack of this, for the English had taken care to maintain a reserve sufficient to feed the garrison and the inhabitants for 3 years, but these provisions were rationed out. Moreover, the regulations were like those aboard a man of war. The English residents, all or nearly all employees of the company or licensed purveyors to the ships, had to obey the laws, which each new governor exerted himself in making more strict. You may not fell trees or kill your own cows. You may not shoot pheasants, game reserved for the governor's table. It is true that doves or partridges could be shot, but on condition that when shot, they should be recovered from the ravines. The slightest suspicion met dismissal. Negroes, mulattoes, Chinese, and Indians lived according to His Majesty's pleasure, slavery being the lot of some and semi-slavery that of others. There were several roads, one a very good one from Jamestown to Plantation House, and a very rough one between the rock and the abyss, without a parapet or rails leading to Longwood. However, good rider one was, the falls were many, and each a dangerous one. The garrison, the island, it seemed, defended itself, but the English had everywhere increased the fortifications. There was not a seemingly accessible point, but that a battery was established there. Upon the arrival of the Emperor, sentries will be stationed on all coasts. A system of signals will keep the governor informed of everything at all times. There will be in the island 500 pieces of artillery and batteries, 24 fighting pieces, and several mortars. There will be a considerable number of other pieces in the storehouses. The troops will be divided between the three chief points, Deadwood, Ladder Hill, and Jamestown. Outposts will be in the position of Sandy Bay, High Peak, Lemon Valley, Egg Island, and Dag Lake. At Deadwood Camp, there will be established the Light Dragoons of the 21st, to the number of 20, commanded by a lieutenant and serving as orderlies and guides. The Royal Engineers, 20 men commanded by a lieutenant. The 2nd Battalion of the 53rd, the regiment will vary, but the effective force will remain obviously similar. 26 officers, 619 NCOs, corporals, drummers, and soldiers. At Ladder Hill, quite near Deadwood, there will be of the Royal Engineers 3 officers and 48 men, of the Royal Artillery 3 officers and 66 men, of the Island Infantry 19 officers and 288 men. At Jamestown, the principal portion of the 2nd Battalion of the 66th Regiment, 17 officers and 420 men, the Island Artillery 16 officers and 376 men, and the Volunteer Infantry 12 officers and 530 men. So 493 officers and NCOs, corporals, and drummers, and 92,991 men would be appointed to look after Napoleon, to prevent any secret landing, any attempted escape, any communication, and they would do service as before an enemy, and any of those not actually under arms must be ready at the first signal. The squadron, in addition to this internal garrison, the island would be guarded as a second line by an entire squadron. These vessels are frigates, 2 men of war, each carrying 20 guns, and 6 brigs with 10 or 12 guns to do duty as scouts or messengers. The little desert island of Ascension being a possible base operation for attempting liberators, a brig would be stationed there, and on the rock would be erected an armed battery guarded by 65 seamen who would be kept supplied from St. Helena with food and fresh water. The officers of the company, prior to 1815, St. Helena had only one master, the representative of the East India Company, under the control of the council directors. At the moment, the company had temporarily resigned its powers into the hands of the crown, and the governor, appointed by the king, assumed all authority. But he no longer exercised the authority of governor of the company, which, if he was a superior officer, was nonetheless somewhat of a contractor for it, offering hospitality to travelers going to or returning from the Indies. Paid and supplied to this effect, he had maintained a courtesy from which no servant of the company had deviated, even regarding the prisoner of Europe. The company's servants certainly had no authority over him, and had received no instructions from the company except that they should return to England. Their reign was without doubt at an end, and they gave way, but they were still able to find means of showing their enmity or their bad breeding. On the other hand, Colonel Mark Wilkes, in his duties since the Emperor's landing, appeared to Las Casas a man of the best breeding and very pleasant. His wife was kind and amiable, his daughter delightful, so much so that Gorgo almost immediately fell madly in love with her. "There's the woman," he cried every time he met her, "the adorable Laura." The Emperor's officers were received in the best possible manner at Plantation House. The governor with his wife and daughter came to visit the Emperor. Besides being of good standing, he had taken part in events likely to interest Napoleon, having for a long period been diplomatic agent of the company among the various Indian princes. In 1810, under the title of Historical Sketches of the South of India, he began the publication of a magnum opus in which he related events in the Kingdom of Mysore up to 1799. It was a history of the sovereign who might have been a most valuable ally to France, and one whom Bonaparte from Egypt had wished to lend a helping hand. Who knows but that these two, Tipu Sahib and Bonaparte, might have destroyed the power of England in the Indies, but in front of both of them arose the man of fate. Oh, that Arthur Wellesley, who was to be the Prince of Waterloo. What a conversationalist this man, who had so well known the heroic defender of Seringapatam, would have been for the Emperor. And then with Wilkes, he might have enjoyed other subjects of conversation: chemistry, the continental blockade, the military system of the two nations, and the two ladies might have adorned the relations with a charm and a particularly welcome pleasantness. The society of the Lieutenant Governor Colonel J. Skelton might have been more invaluable still. The Emperor, who had followed the Skeltons into their house at Longwood, gladly persuaded them to stay to dinner. When they came to see him, rode and drove with the Colonel and played chess with Mrs. Skelton, in whom he inspired a respectful compassion. Here is a proof of this which no one will question. When about a month after the Wilkes, the Skeltons were due to leave St. Helena on May 13, 1816, Mrs. Skelton showed herself disturbed, apprehensive, and reluctant at leaving the Emperor in the new governor's hands. She said she would very much have liked to take away with her some souvenir of the Emperor. She spoke like someone who desired a present, wrote Gorgo, who, in a genuine desire for a memento, perceived a greedy disposition. She received nothing, not even a flower which his hand had touched, and immediately after her landing in England, she wrote to Madame Mère. She gave her news of the prisoner and assured her that on May 13th, he was very well. "You cannot conceive," replied Fesch to her on August 22nd, "the happiness your letter has brought to my sister and me. It is the first time we have had any news from Longwood. What request can I make of you without presuming to be troublesome to you? You yourself can realize how his mother and his uncle cherish with all their hearts any good news you can tell them. Has he received our news? Can we get any to him? Would you be so obliging as to inform us of anything you learned from St. Helena? Would you let us know what we can send him which will be pleasing to him, books or anything?" Was it not a kindly thought of this woman to remember with maternal solicitude that, despite national hatreds and prejudices, there was a sorrowing mother? She wrote very simply, "I have seen him, he is well." And this letter brought the first proof that he was still alive.